Hi everyone, welcome or welcome back to my channel. My name is Emily and today we are talking about the things that I love in books. I was trying to do a top five different things, but I kept coming up with ideas and having a hard time narrowing it down. So I ended up picking six different either plot devices or tropes or just like bookish elements that I really enjoy, and then four or five books to recommend for each of those things. Because that is a lot of elements and books, I'm not gonna go in depth into synopsis for the different books. We're not really gonna dive too deep into those particular aspects within the book, but I just wanted to have some recommendations to give to you and some ideas of things that, you know, really work for me. But I wanted to be able to talk about at least a couple of books that have worked for me in that particular area. That's not to say that all of these books are five stars. I do really like each of these books that I've picked out, but specifically for the elements that I'm talking about, if that makes sense. I would also love to have recommendations from all of you about books that fit into these different types or categories or whatever. But anyway, without any more rambling, I am going to dive into the six different things that I love in books. First up, and the thing that really inspired the idea for this video, is a book that is recounting a story or a life, someone's like entire lifetime. I've read a lot of books that fall into this category, and I like it for a couple of different reasons. One, I like that sort of meta quality of a story within a story. I think that is a fun, like the narrator is also a character and a main player in the story, if that makes sense. I know that's true of a lot of like first person books, but where they are like telling someone a story and they are like the main character of it, I don't know, that works for me. It means for me often that I feel really attached and connected to that story because it feels so personal. They often make me emotional because in theory, they're coming directly from the source. Obviously, these are fictional stories, but I don't know, it makes me feel very connected to the main character, and a lot of these books in this group of books that I've read like that have made me cry. I think because I often feel super attached to the character and the story because it feels like it's coming directly from the source. And as much as I do like slice of life contemporaries, I also really love getting the context of a person's entire life. I think I enjoy both for different reasons, and I think obviously there's a place and a time and reasoning for both types of stories. But I do really like getting to know a character as a complete person rather than just in the context of what they're dealing with now, maybe like flashing back and giving like a little bit of backstory. I like getting the full backstory, like leading up to where they are today. Again, going back to that idea of like this coming directly from the source, I like that it gives it sort of an unreliable narrator quality, and that like we can't assume that 100% of what they're saying is accurate because everything is influenced by emotions and how a certain person experienced an event. And I don't know, something about that to me makes it a little bit more interesting, and that leads me to like the first book that I want to talk about for this. The Name of the Wind is the only fantasy story on this list. The rest are all historical fiction, I believe. This one, he says at the very beginning, like, I'm going to tell you my story, but I'm not going to guarantee that everything is true and accurate. I don't know why I love that like cheekiness to it. I think it's really fun. It really works for me. It definitely worked in this particular book. And now the other four are actually a person, an older person, telling their life story to a younger individual. First and foremost, The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo. We all knew this was coming. This is a story of a movie star who is now in her, I think, 70s or 80s, and she is sharing her life story with a journalist. The Boston Girl by Anita Diamant is about a woman who is telling the story to her granddaughter of when she was young and moved from Russia to Boston and grew up as a young Jewish woman in I want to say the 1910s. Yes, starting in 1915. Then we have City of Girls by Elizabeth Gilbert, which I read earlier this year and talked about in my like first quarter wrap up. This is about a young woman who moves to New York City after getting kicked out of college and her years living in like theater life and like as an artist in the city. And then finally, we have The Nightingale by Kristen Hanna, and this actually fits for a couple different tropes in this list, or elements in this list. First and foremost is this is a woman sharing her story about growing up in World War II. The story itself is primarily about two sisters, and we get sporadically, we get chapters from one of the sisters when she is much, much older. You don't know which one it is until the end, and you're constantly trying to guess who it is, and it's so, so well done. Going off of that, the next one is all about the narrator, and I don't want to just say like unreliable or unexpected, but it's just when the narrator turns out to not be quite what you expect, or they are just not who you would expect to be telling the story, if that makes sense. I like this because it again adds sort of an air of mystery and keeps you guessing throughout. I think it can be done really well, and it can also be done not so well, where like it just doesn't connect you to the story in the right way. I like that with The Nightingale, you do have to kind of guess, or you're constantly guessing who the sister is, and you don't find out until the end. This one, I'm not really at all gonna go into a synopsis of any of them, even briefly, because it can be kind of spoilery. We have Room by Emma Donahue, which is a contemporary story. Huge trigger warnings for rape, kidnapping, and pedophilia. It's a really heavy book. It's narrated by a 5-year-old. Next is The Book Thief by Marcus Zusak. This is narrated by Death, and it is also a World War II story. Career of Evil by Robert Galbraith is the third book in the Cormoran Strike series, J.K. Rowling's mystery series. And this one is interesting because we get occasional chapters from the murderer, the serial killer themselves. You don't know who it is. You know of all the different suspects, but you don't actually know which one it is. So it's weirdly kind of similar to The Nightingale, where you're like trying to guess which suspect it is, and you're trying to guess which sister it is. That's a really weird comparison, and wow, that just occurred to me right at this second. Next is Gone Girl by Gillian Flynn. Again, this is a classic unreliable narrator one. I'm not gonna say anything more than that because it's a spoiler. Same thing goes for The Fifth Season by N.K. Jemisin. I'm not gonna say anything about it, but basically there are three different points of view, and you don't really know how they connect, but when you find out, it's so good. Going off of that, see how they're all sort of connected? I don't know that I can pull that off going into the rest of the elements, so we'll just live in that for now. But the next one is Multiple POVs. I love a good story with multiple points of view, multiple narrators. It does not always work for me. I can definitely think of some examples where I really disliked that it had multiple narrators, but when it works for me, it really works. I also really like when it is kind of giving you bits of information through each character individually, but not the whole picture. And I think that one really especially pertains to Six of Crows by Leigh Bardugo. This is narrated by 5 of the 6 main characters, but this one is definitely a case where you get some of the information, but not all of it. Then I have Daisy Jones and the Six by Taylor Jenkins Reid. This is not quite multiple POV in the same way, because it's an interviewer speaking with all the different members of the band, as you can kind of tell. Like, you'll get an answer from Billy, and then Daisy, and Rod, whoever, Simone, all these different characters. But this one I like because of that thing I was mentioning in the like sharing of a story, is you hear how the band members individually experienced different events based on where they were, or just like how they remember it, which I thought was really interesting. Next is Salt to the Sea by Ruta Sepetys. This is following 4 characters who were aboard the Wilhelm Gustloff, which was a German ship that was supposed to be ferrying refugees to safety, and it was a really horrific Wreck. But this one has, like I said, four different characters that you're following, and the chapters are really short, and they all start out separately and then come together before getting aboard the ship. Next we have The One by John Mars. This is a sort of sci-fi futuristic story. It has, I think, six different perspectives. This one, whereas like it's not one story that we're getting multiple perspectives from, it's just like they all have one thing in common and are experiencing a common event, but in different ways, and they're all very different people. It's fascinating. I loved it. And then finally, The Priory of the Orange Tree by Samantha Shannon, which was one of my favorite books of last year. This is a like 1,000-page fantasy story, and it has four different characters who all exist in the same world but are doing different things within, leading up to like this supposed like rise of this like demon, god, devil, dragon. It's really hard to describe these in like three sentences. Some of them are in one place the whole time, some are going on adventures. Tying that into one of the elements, adventure, sort of. This one is adventure or like a trip or travel of some sort. These don't all quite have the exact same type of travel involved, but I love accompanying a character or group of characters on a long trip, and I like the two aspects of it for different reasons. When it's just one person, it feels very contemplative and really reflective, and it's usually them like thinking about their lives or whatever. But then I also like when it's a couple of characters or a group of characters and they are learning more about each other, or just they're building community because of this adventure or trip or whatever it is. I feel like this one is a little bit of a stretch to lump all of these together because they are all pretty different, but I like them because it allows for that long form, like either togetherness or time alone. So for the ones where the characters are alone, the first is A Heart and a Body in the World by Deb Colletti, which is a contemporary story about a young woman. She's, I believe, going into her senior year of high school, or maybe junior year, and she experiences some pretty traumatic gun violence and has just, had kind of a traumatic event happen, and so she decides to run across the country. She runs from Washington to, I want to say, like Pennsylvania or Virginia or something like that. And yeah, we get a lot of time inside her head where she's reflecting and just kind of coming to terms with what happened and trying to not like reconcile the trauma, but just like, I don't know how to describe it. Yeah, it's very, very reflective and introspective, and it's heartbreaking and beautiful all at once. The next one is Sadie by Courtney Summers. This is again a really hard-hitting contemporary about Sadie, whose sister Maddie was kidnapped and then found dead, and so Sadie goes to basically try to find her killer. It is definitely that long-form travel where she is pretty much inside her own head. She also doesn't really speak to other people much, but very, very reflective. But then some adventure stories that involve groups of people where they're all kind of different but coming together for a purpose. I have to mention like the classic adventure story, which is The Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien. I have not and really don't plan to read the Lord of the Rings trilogy, but I really liked The Hobbit when I read it a couple of years ago. I don't really remember a lot, but I do remember just like enjoying the friendship aspect of the adventure where they are, you know, going on this together for like a common purpose or whatever. I don't know. I couldn't not mention this one. Then a book that I read last year and absolutely loved, and it made it into my top 10, is The Long Way to a Small Angry Planet by Becky Chambers. This one is about a group aboard a space vessel. They are all of different species, planets, races, etc., and it is about them sort of just like learning to work together to complete a mission that they've been given. Yeah, so good. It's exactly the type of spacey sci-fi that I like. And finally, again, another pretty classic adventure-y, like journey type book is Station 11 by Emily St. John Mandel. This is not one that I would necessarily recommend reading right now. It's following like a global pandemic, essentially, where most of the world has died, and we follow a troupe of performers who just travel around trying to provide entertainment to the small factions of people that now exist on their own. And this is one that I want to reread because I read it maybe 3 years ago, and I think it's one that I would get more from now. I mean, not right now, because I don't know that I'm at the stage of reading about a pandemic. Maybe, I don't know. Okay, I don't know how to tie in the next two. I don't know if there's like a thread. Yeah, so the next one is sisters. I am a sister. I'm very attached to my identity as an oldest sister and very close with my sister. How many times can I say sister? But she was actually just in my last video helping Adam with, as a lifeline for trying to guess my bookish answers. I love a story that really highlights strong sister relationships. I just like that this can exist in so many different genres and types of stories, and it can be the main focus of a book, or it can just be sort of a side plot, or even just in the background. It is definitely something that I really connect to, obviously, as a sister. And again, like with the first one, a lot of these books make me weep because I feel so strongly connected to that aspect of the story. First up, as I'm sure you can guess, is Little Women by Louisa May Alcott. This is about four sisters growing up in Civil War era US, and I love it so much. I just love how these sisters are all so different, and yet they just love each other so much, and they just want the best for each other. I just love that. I love this so much. I think all of these are in different genres, which is really cool. So that is like a classic, of course, contemporary setting, Summer of Salt by Katrina Leno. This is about twin sisters who are about to leave their home island for the first time when they go off to college. And there is sort of like a tension in their relationship. And I think a lot of the story is them learning more about each other and learning to not take each other for granted. I think that's part of it, but it's really, really beautiful. For historical fiction, and again, I said it comes up in multiple elements, is Nightingale by Kristen Hannah. I like that this is about sisters together and apart, their individualism and their relationship with each other. I think that's really a cool aspect of it. For fantasy, we have In an Absent Dream by Seanan MacGuire. The sister relationship in this, really, it is not like necessarily the focal point of the story, but it's so good, and it made me cry. And then dystopian, of course, The Hunger Games by Suzanne Collins. I get super emotional every time I read or watch Katniss volunteer to take Prim's place. I think their relationship is so wholesome and so unconditional, and I love them both so much. And then finally, the last one that I want to talk about is Friends to Lovers. I love a good rivals or enemies to lovers as well, but there's something about building that foundation of friendship first, and I think it often allows us to get to know the characters individually before we get to know them as a couple, which I really, really like. So first is The Start of Me and You by Emery Lord. This follows the friendship of Paige and Max. Paige is like desperately in love with Max's cousin Ryan, and she sort of hopes to get closer to Ryan through Max, but also they just have a lot in common, and I mean, you can pretty much know from the start that they are going to end up together, but their like building of their friendship as Max is a new student at the school is just very sweet. Next is I Wish You All the Best by Mason Deaver. This is about a non-binary teen named Ben who is kicked out of their home after they come out as non-binary to their parents. They move in with their sister and started a new school. Ben meets a student who is going to sort of show them around campus and get them acquainted with the school and whatnot. And they build a friendship, and it's really lovely. And I mean, the book is just fantastic in and of itself. But I loved the friendship to relationship part of this story very, very much. The next two are much more recent reads. First is The Last True Poets of the Sea by Julia Drake. Not only does this have a friends to lovers aspect to it, but there's also a really cool love triangle that's like a true triangle. I personally don't feel strongly about love triangles as a trope. I know some people love them and some people hate them. I feel pretty neutral, but this one I really liked it. I thought it was really interesting, and it's like friends to lovers, like on all sides. And then I know I've said that this is a rivals to lovers, but I think I can also argue that it is more rivals to friends to lovers, and that is Beach Read by Emily Henry. Did I just want to talk about this again? Maybe. But as I mentioned, this follows January and Gus, who were rivals in college, and then January has this inner thought of like, oh, I can't be romantically interested in him because it'll ruin everything, and like he wouldn't want to be with me anyway, that sort of thing. They become really good friends though, and then eventually do get together. So yeah, love that it is sort of a progression from rivals to lovers, and that there is that friendship in between. All right, that is everything. I had a lot of fun thinking about all of these different things, and it made me want to start looking more intentionally for some of these things as I browse for my next read. So if you have any suggestions for any of these, please let me know in the comments. You can also find links to all of my social media accounts in the description box if you'd like to connect with me there. Be sure to subscribe if you haven't already so you don't miss out on my next video. But until then, happy reading. Bye.